Bantam Audio Publishing presents a Doubleday production of Bells, Bears, and Fishermen by Carly Simon. Amy the Dancing Bear. It was almost Amy's bedtime, and she probably knew it. Her mother, a large and graceful bear, appeared in Amy's doorway and said, "Amy, my darling girl, though the moon is not yet so high in the sky, it is time you changed into your nightgown or nightshirt or whatever you're wearing to bed these days." "Mother," pleaded Amy, "the sun is still coming through the trees. It is filtered and dappled, and the air still smells of fresh-mown hay. Please let me dance here in my room until the moon is a little higher and the sun a little lower. I'm so happy with my pirouettes and so filled with joy." How could her mother argue with that? How could she cut short this delight, this artful little creature with her sunny auburn curls and her graceful turns like tropical palms moving in the wind? So she spoke in a practical tone. "Amy, I will go into the kitchen and I'll wash all the dishes. When I come back in here, I would like to see you ready for bed." "Thank you, Mother." Amy threw her hands off in another direction and the rest of her body followed. Amy's mother went into the kitchen and washed each glass, plate, and even polished the knives and forks with a special pink polish until each was so shiny you could see your reflection in it if you felt like it. Then she returned to Amy's room. "Amy?" Her mother's voice was more stern. "I don't see that anything has changed."
"Dear mother, the sun has turned to gold, and my room is filled with the magic of twilight. There is nothing I couldn't invent in here now, no step too difficult for my body to take. The birds are only beginning their goodnight songs, and this is just the music I've waited for. I am so inspired and not in the least bit tired. Please, oh please, let me just dance a little more, just a little more."
Her mother, who was charmed by her daughter, could again hardly refuse such a pleasant little argument. So she spoke with motherly understanding. "Darling girl, you are nearly incorrigible, but this is the last time. I shall go into the living room and listen to one side of a piano sonata. And then when I return, I shall expect to find you in bed. I mean between the sheets." And with that command, she went into the living room and found her favorite record and put it on the turntable and sat back in the sofa with a cool glass of iced tea. As certain as the piano sonata was over in 17 minutes, so Amy's mother was certain she would find her daughter at least in her nightgown, nightshirt, or pajamas. But sometimes Amy's mother was wrong. When she came a third time into Amy's room, Amy was in the middle of a tango with an imaginary partner, her eyes glowing and turned toward the evening sky. "Amy, you know I am not harsh or strict and never utter a sound that resembles a bark in your direction. But really, my child, you push me to the limit. Next, you'll be asking me if you can stay up dancing until the sun rises in the east.
I know you think I am disobedient and disrespectful, but sometimes, Mother, my spirit rises and something in me says, stay right where you are. Do you see the moon and how it appears at the horizon? Look at the lightning bugs and then the same twinkling farther up in the sky of the early stars. I feel I can float through arabesques. And when the night mists drift through the window on the soft night breeze, it makes me want to dance forever. Can you believe how happy I must be?"
Well, if only everybody could feel that way. Since it was summer and there was no school, Amy's mother decided not to scold Amy. Instead, her voice was low and gentle. "All right, my darling dancing little bear, dance on. I'll be in the bathtub. I'll come in when I'm washed and dry, and by then you'll be quite tired."
Amy was so happy that her mother understood that she gave a low curtsy and then jumped impishly into her mother's arms for a big hug. Amy's mother, always somewhat of a sport, moved sleepily into the bathroom where she ran a bath, adding foam of apple blossoms so that the bubbles finally rose higher than the edge of the tub itself. When she got into this fine warm bath, she lay her head back and let herself relax very deeply. She began to think of Uncle Harry and his watch that never told the time. She thought about her recipe for baked Alaska, and she thought about piano sonatas. She thought about Amy and how much she really loved to dance. As she was thinking about the red woolen mittens she planned to knit for next fall, she drifted off into that kind of peaceful sleep that only happy thoughts can give rise to. Mama! Dearest mother! Dear, oh dear, it must be so late. You've fallen to sleep in the tub. Amy smiled down at her mother as if she were her own precious little baby. Come on, it's time to go to bed. Let me help you dry off. Amy reached, still in her dance, for a big soft towel that was hanging on a hook nearby. Coming out of her dreams for a minute, Amy's mother parted the bubbles as she stepped out of the tub. After she was all dry and snuggled into a loose-fitting blue nightie, Amy's mother, still blinking back sleep, let Amy lead her into her big cozy bed. Amy tucked the covers around her mother and opened the window just wide enough to let a stream of cool honeysuckled air into the room. As she kissed her mother goodnight, her mother kissed her back and noticed that Amy was finally dressed in her pajamas. She noticed, too, that the moon was high in the sky and that the stars gathered into a constellation designed by the heavens to form one perfectly happy, perfectly tireless, perfectly wonderful dancing bear. The Boy of the Bells. In a small village, very far up north, there lived a grandfather and his two grandchildren. The village was called Noel because from September all the way to April it felt like Christmas there. Indeed, Noel was the first stop on Santa's well-mapped voyage around the world. In October, the townspeople of Noel began making Christmas wreaths out of the wildflowers and pines still fresh and sweet after the short months of summer. By early November, nearly every house had a decorated Christmas tree, and snow Santas of all shapes and sizes sat plump and frozen in front yards and on porches. Grandfather Juniper and his two grandchildren, Miranda and Ben, lived in a little house attached to the village church, where Grandfather Juniper's job was to mark time by ringing the bells in the steeple from 6 in the morning until midnight. He had been doing this for 53 years. But this Christmas, Grandfather was tired and worried about Miranda. His concern had begun one morning last winter when Miranda joined Ben and Grandfather for breakfast, but had said not one word. They ignored it at first, explaining her silence as sleepiness or maybe a bad mood. But even now, these many months later, it continued. She seemed to hear everything, and though she often smiled sweetly in response to her teacher's questions or Ben's funny jokes, she never uttered a sound. No one could figure it out. not even the village doctor who examined her with his stethoscope and knee-jerking hammer. She, who loved to sing, didn't sing anymore. Mostly she sat in her room with her books or made sketches of the pine trees draped with snow outside her window. She cooked the family's meals, but sat silently, while Ben and Grandfather tried in vain to get her to say even one word. Ben felt he had lost his best friend. Christmas Eve was but one short night away. Because Grandfather was so weary, he asked Ben, only 10 years old, to take his place in the belfry. Ben felt honored to ring the bells on such a special night. He always enjoyed watching his grandfather pull the big cord, which made the bell ring, allowing a sound like no other to fill the air. He had slowly learned the technique from his grandfather, but only recently were his arms strong enough to pull sufficiently hard on the rope. Christmas Eve arrived with a moonless sky. A strong west wind piled snow high up on the window panes. Miranda was making a hearty Christmas soup, and neighbors had brought fresh bread and plum pudding into Grandfather Juniper's kitchen. The red candles were lit, and a fire in the hearth cast a warm and comforting glow on the visitors. "Here's to the merriest Christmas yet," said Jonathan the baker as he lifted his glass of cranberry punch. "And here's to young Ben's first night alone in the bell tower. Take a blanket and pillows with you, and maybe some plum pudding in case you get hungry," his grandfather said, sending him off with a smile. "Merry Christmas, Ben," said all his rosy-faced friends. Miranda just looked at her brother and blew him a kiss. Ben climbed up the spiral staircase to the tower. There were 32 steps. They were crooked, and most of them had squeaks and creaks. He checked his watch, 6 minutes before 8 o'clock. His heart was filled with pride and excitement as he settled into Grandfather Juniper's big, comfortable chair. "Am I really going to meet Santa Claus?" he wondered. "What will he think when he sees me instead of Grandfather?" He took the rope in his hands, and at exactly 8 o'clock, he rang the big bell. It sounded crisp and melodious as it rang through the little village. Children all over Noel heard it and readied themselves for bed. Stockings were hung, and parents kissed, and cookies and milk left on kitchen tables. Lights dimmed in the windows of the sleepy town. By the time Ben rang the 10 o'clock bell, the town was hushed and the fires were out. Ben wondered if Miranda was still awake listening to him sound the chimes. Was she proud? Was she excited? Ben wished he knew. He wanted his sister to be happy. He wanted her to speak again and care again and sing again and be lively and talk and talk and talk and talk. Then Ben had an idea. What if he sounded the bell 12 times at 11 o'clock? And maybe Santa would get to Noel an hour early and Ben would have a chance to talk to him and explain about Miranda's silence. Maybe Santa could help. He thought about his plan and said to himself, "Yes. This is so important. Santa will understand." At 11 o'clock, Ben took the heavy cord in his hands and pulled it hard and with confidence. 12 times the bell rang through the night. Then he sat back down in the chair and waited. The only sound was the wind blowing the fine flakes of snow against the west window of the tower. Up at the North Pole, Santa woke from a deep sleep and thought,
"Something is odd." "What is this?"
said Santa.
"Am I growing so old and tired that I don't hear my wife call my name?"
But then he looked over and saw that Mrs. Claus was just as surprised as he was. "Oh, dear, hurry, Nicholas," she urged. "I'll help you dress. I guess our alarm clock must be broken. There were 12 chimes from Noel, I'm sure of it." Santa mumbled awake, donned his red suit, grabbed a biscuit, and mounted his sleigh. His reindeer were quite confused by this rapid departure.
"Good reindeer, don't worry, my friends. We'll make up some time over the ocean. The wind's from the west. We're in luck."
He blew a kiss to Mrs. Claus and took off in a swirl of strong winds, snow, and confusion. In but a minute or two, they were in Noel.
Santa parked his sleigh in the sky by the clock tower and entered the warm room usually occupied by his good friend Juniper. He was surprised to see Ben instead. Ben wasted no time explaining.
Oh, Santa, I struck the bells an hour early because I have to talk to you. Grandfather asked me to take over because he was tired. You see, he's terribly worried about Miranda. That's my sister. She hasn't talked in almost a year, and we don't know why. We're all so upset about it, and I'm so lonely because she's my best friend. And, well, gosh, I really hoped you might be able to make her talk again.
Ben said this excitedly, all in one breath, as he looked up into Santa's eyes and saw an expression that was nearly the opposite of a twinkle. He was afraid to name it. Santa, I hope I haven't made you angry with me.
You know, Ben, your grandfather gave you a big job. All year I wait for those bells. All year I work hard, making my sack of toys and sleigh ready for just this night.
Santa frowned at Ben, obviously very annoyed. His face was definitely not merry or rosy, and in fact his belly looked a bit less robust than in pictures.
Oh dear, Ben said, I guess I didn't think hard enough about it.
There are many children all over the world who have problems, but I don't have a magic wand to make their problems disappear. No, Ben, this is your challenge.
Santa was stern, but a gentle understanding was not far from creeping back into his crinkly eyes.
I'm so sorry, Santa. I was only trying to help Miranda. Don't leave anything for me this year. But please, is there anything you can explain to me about Miranda's silence?
I'm sorry about your sister, Ben, said Santa, but I can't always tell you why some things happen the way they do. There are many mysteries in the universe. I can tell you why it stays so cold in the North Pole most of the year, but I can't tell you why I get a warm feeling of excitement all down my back when I hear a church bell ring. But one thing we learn in the North Pole is to do the very best job just for today that we ourselves can do.
Just for today? Asked Ben uncertainly.
Listen well, son.
Santa stroked his whiskers and put his arm around Ben's shoulder.
Yes, Santa?
Said Ben, ready to take on the most impossible task.
When you wake the town this morning, ring the bells as if you were the greatest musician on earth. Make each stroke count. Invent sounds you've never heard before. Reach deep down inside you for inspiration. Make your grandfather proud.
As Santa turned to go, he looked back at Ben and said,
This is just between you and me, right, Ben?
Thank you, Santa.
Ben blew Santa a kiss. Santa's eyes lit up with Santa light and glowed like two fire opals beneath his snow-white eyebrows. Off he disappeared, and Ben heard only the faint ringing of sleigh bells as Santa and his reindeer sailed up and then farther up into the snowy Christmas night. Maybe it was just good luck, or the way the wind was blowing, or the way the snow was drifting, or the way the pines were swaying, but no one at all in the town of Noel was awake to hear the bells toll a second time, at the actual stroke of midnight. Some children murmured and shifted position under their comforters. Some grown-ups had dreams about when they were children. Miranda dreamed of a little house by the sea where the cries of seagulls announced the hours of the day as they streamed through the blue summer skies. Grandfather Juniper dreamed of Ben holding a great silver baton and conducting an orchestra in the sky. But Ben was not even a little bit tired. He was planning a feast of sounds. 40 or more dusty bells, gongs, and chimes of every kind that Grandfather had used over the years were stacked up all around the floor and shelves of the bell tower. Between midnight and 1 o'clock, Ben dusted them all, tried each one for tone and pitch, and assembled them in a row. Ben chose a small bell to peal the first hour of Christmas morning. After all, he didn't want to wake anyone. At 2, 3, 4, and 5 in the morning, Ben added more and more bells, learning about their magical sounds as he tried each one. And then, as the sky began to brighten in the east, as the snow tapered off to a flurry and as the wind softened to a whisper, Ben gathered his instruments beside him, his sticks, mallets, and hammers in his hands, his gongs, bells, and chimes spread out in front of him. It was close to 6 o'clock. Ben was tired, but not tired. He was excited, but calm. He felt chilly, but somehow on fire. He wanted Grandfather to be proud and Santa to forgive him. Listening to a quiet voice inside him, a voice more like music than words, Ben began to ring the bells. He was open to the songs of all the heavens. It was a symphony of bells, chimes from India and Africa, gongs from China and Iceland. Bells from all over the world sounded together, an ocean of bells. Gusty blasts of music filled the morning air and woke the dreamers. Boys and girls all over Noel ran to the hearths where they had hung their stockings the night before. Parents and grandparents, aunts and uncles pleaded for a few more minutes of warmth and quiet before leaving their beds to start their wood fires and put on the coffee. But everyone, absolutely everyone, could hear the magic coming from the bell tower in the center of the village. Maybe it lasted 1 minute, maybe more like 10. But the symphony of bells remained in everyone's memory for the rest of their lives. Ben was so thrilled he could have kept on ringing the bells all morning, but he heard something that made him pause. He heard footsteps on the stairs leading up to the bell tower. They creaked slow and steady, soft and feminine. Ben? Ben? Miranda appeared, a glimmering figure in the doorway. Ben stopped and turned in surprise. Ben, that's the most beautiful sound I've ever heard. I really thought I was dreaming. I can't believe it's you. Miranda laughed, and a ray of sunlight made her presence even more dazzling. Her eyes shone with joy as they hadn't for months, which made tears come to Ben's eyes. Miranda, I'm so happy! Merry Christmas, it's so good to hear you again. Merry Christmas, Ben. Come on, let's go downstairs, make breakfast, and open our presents. Ben followed his sister down the rickety stairs, but he looked to the sky as he descended. Thank you, Mr. Santa Claus, he said in a whisper, and he imagined Santa's face before him. For a second or two, he was sure he heard Santa's sleigh bells, and Santa seemed to be saying, "It was you, Ben. It was all you." The Fisherman's Song. In a pine forest cooler than the rest of the island lives a young fisherman with eyes like the sea. He built his own boat and he made his own cabin, but he's broken the hearts of the likes of me. Now you must understand, he made me a promise. There were secrets we shared. We planted a tree. We lived in his cabin. I fished alongside of him. I fell under the spell of his sorcery. When he cast me adrift at the end of the summer, it was not for another, but his own privacy. I fell apart like a rose, but the scent of my longing remains, and it weeps like an old willow tree. At night, when it's still, with a yellow moon rising, when his candle is snuffed and he's deep in a dream, I move like a cat and crawl into his window and lie down beside him in a golden moonbeam. The smell of his skin is just like the summer, when our love was as fresh as the grass in the fields, and ever so softly, I kiss his eyelids before slipping away, my secret concealed. Though I'm in it alone, I'm still in it, in love. And love can be lonely like a sweet melody. But just maybe he feels me like a whisper inside him, like an angel beside him, keeping him company.
In a pine forest cooler than the rest of the island lives a young fisherman with eyes like the sea. He built his own boat and made his own cabin, but he's broken the hearts of the likes of me. Now you must understand, he made me a promise. There were secrets we shared. We planted a tree. We lived in his cabin. I fished alongside of him. I fell under the spell of his sorcery. He cast me adrift at the end of the summer. It was not for another, but his own privacy. I fell apart like a rose, but the scent of my longing remains, and it weeps like an old willow tree. Night when it's still, with the yellow moon rising, when his candle is snuffed and he's deep in a dream, I move like a cat and crawl into his window and lie down beside him in a golden moonbeam. Just like the summer when our love was as fresh as the grass in the fields, and ever so softly I kiss his eyelids before slipping away, my secret concealed. Though I'm in it alone, I'm still in it in love. And love can be lonely like a sweet melody, but just maybe he feels me like a whisper inside him, like an angel beside him, keeping him company.
This is Carly Simon. We hope you have enjoyed this Doubleday production of Bells, Bears, and Fishermen. This program was produced and directed by Carly Simon, Jimmy Ryan, and T. Skoll. The music was performed by T. Skoll on keyboards and Jimmy Ryan on guitar and seagulls. Production copyright 1992, Bantam Audio Publishing. All rights reserved. The books Amy the Dancing Bear, The Boy of the Bells, and The Fisherman's Song are available from Doubleday, wherever books are sold. Bye.